Tentor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Black Boom by Jason L. Riley, narrated by Amir Abdullah. Introduction. Belief that the economic advancement of racial and ethnic minority groups is conditioned on political clout and government programs is widely held, but the supporting evidence is thinner than many people realize. Historically, groups that have risen fastest from poverty into the American middle class, the Germans, Jews, and Japanese, among others, did so with little, if any, political power. The focus was not on electing their own to office, but rather on developing the human capital, the education, skills, work habits, and attitudes that facilitates upward mobility. By comparison, the Irish who arrived in the mid-19th century enjoyed tremendous political success while simultaneously lagging economically. By the late 1900s, Irish political machines were operating in cities from San Francisco to Chicago to Boston. Financially, however, the Irish trailed not only most Americans, but also other immigrant groups that didn't come close to matching the political influence of the Irish. In fact, among all European immigrants to America, the Irish rose the slowest economically, and it wasn't until the decline of these political machines that a substantial Irish middle class began to emerge. Likewise, among blacks, political and economic success historically have not moved in lockstep. Following the Civil War, politics emerged as the principal focus of black aspirations, writes historian Eric Foner in his History of Reconstruction. Although whites generally retained political control, the fact that well over 600 blacks, the majority former slaves, served as legislators represented a stunning change in American politics. A small number of these path-breaking elected officials improved their own financial lot, but not necessarily that of their black constituents. Although some black politicians achieved bourgeois status and others aspired to it, few successfully translated political power into a share of economic growth of their states. Foner writes, indeed, for many blacks, political involvement led not to social mobility, but to devastating loss. Some 100 years later, following passage of the Civil Rights Act of 1964 and the Voting Rights Act of 1965, black leaders would begin another major push for political power to help remedy social inequality. Between 1970 and 2010, the number of black elected officials climbed from fewer than 1,500 to more than 10,000. The list would include black mayors of major U.S. cities, black state legislators, black governors, black members of Congress, and, of course, Barack Obama, the first black president. Those decades happened to coincide with a major expansion of the welfare state initiated by Lyndon Johnson's Great Society programs and continued by his successor, Richard Nixon. Yet this period also featured slower black progress in some areas and outright retrogression in others. In the wake of the war on poverty, black labor force participation declined, black unemployment rates rose, and the black nuclear family disintegrated. Between 1960 and 1995, the proportion of black children living with both parents fell from 2/3 to 1/3. It turns out that the most significant progress among blacks had coincided neither with greater political representation nor with massive welfare state interventions. Rather, blacks have tended to do better when the country's economy is doing better and they have had access to labor markets. What's needed, more than political saviors, racial preferences, and wealth redistribution schemes, is economic growth and opportunity. The greatest 25 years of black progress after emancipation itself came between the early post-war period and around 1973, writes Ohio University labor economist Richard Vetter. The real median income of the black population more than doubled between 1948 and 1973, increasing an astonishing 3% per year. If average instead of medians are used to calculate real income, the increase was even larger. Another recent analysis of black social mobility in the 20th century reaches a similar conclusion. The progress toward equality for black Americans didn't begin in 1965, write Harvard political scientist Robert Putnam and his co-author Shailen Romney Garrett in their 2020 book, The Upswing. By many measures, blacks were moving toward parity with whites well before the victories of the Civil Rights Revolution, despite the limitations imposed by Jim Crow. Moreover, after the Civil Rights Movement, that long-standing trend toward racial equality slowed, stopped, and even reversed. The emphasis is the author's. Overall, African American incomes rose relative to white incomes for the first two-thirds of the century, they add. And most scholars agree that income levels by race converged at the greatest rate between 1940 and 1970. In 2016, Barack Obama saw his preferred successor, Hillary Clinton, go down in shocking defeat to Donald Trump. Not only did blacks lose substantial political clout, but the new president was presented in the mainstream media as a racist, whose policies would harm the interests of racial and ethnic minorities. Yet over the next 3 years, blacks and Hispanics experienced record low rates of unemployment and poverty, and wages for workers at the bottom rose faster than they did for management. Prior to the global pandemic, black Americans were significantly better off economically under Trump than they'd ever been under Obama. Whether that was the goal of the Trump administration or an unintended consequence is outside the purview of this slim volume. You will not find a psychoanalysis of the former president by me in the essay that follows. I did not vote for Trump in 2016 or in 2020. My newspaper columns and television commentary regularly took the administration to task for its immigration restrictionism and trade protectionism. Nor did Trump's derogatory comments about women and minorities, his marble-mouthed responses to white nationalists, and his behavior on January 6, 2021, when his supporters ransacked the Capitol, escape my criticism. Nevertheless, this book was not written to score partisan political points. Rather, its purpose is to tell an underreported story about black economic advancement in the pre-pandemic economy, why it happened, and which kinds of public policies facilitated it. Most of the media could not see past Trump's Twitter feed and serial norm breaking. That was perhaps understandable on some level, but it's no excuse for wholesale abandonment of fairness and objectivity. The reality is that racial inequality improved on Trump's watch, and much of the media were too busy agitating against him to take note or give credit where it was due. Reporters suspended any professional and ethical standards in a concerted effort to take down a president they didn't like. In some respects, their behavior was no less reckless than Donald Trump's. Part 1. The Black Boom. Chapter 1. Black Progress. Trump versus Obama. A few months after Joe Biden took office, the New York Times published a column by David Brooks about Donald Trump supporters and how they were responding to the young Biden presidency. According to Brooks, there were increasing signs that the Trumpian base is radicalizing, and that Republican voters were exhibiting apocalyptic pessimism regarding the new administration. "What's happening can only be called a venomous panic attack," he wrote. "Since the election, large swaths of the Trumpian right have decided America is facing a crisis like never before, and they're the small army of warriors fighting with Alamo-level desperation to ensure the survival of the country as they conceive it." Though Brooks never says so in the column, these reactions were every bit as applicable to the political left's end is nigh rhetoric surrounding the election of Trump 4 years earlier. Less than 2 weeks after Trump took office, one commentator even claimed that his presidency posed an existential danger to America. That commentator's name was David Brooks. If Brooks' take on Trump loyalists displayed a stunning lack of self-awareness, his own apocalyptic pessimism regarding Trump's 2016 victory over Hillary Clinton was hardly unique among media elites. Slate magazine said that Trump's win revealed our unjust, racist, sexist country for what it is. The New Yorker magazine wrote that the outcome was nothing less than a tragedy for the American Republic, a tragedy for the Constitution, and a triumph for the forces at home and abroad of nativism, authoritarianism, misogyny, and racism. The reason why such feverish reactions to Trump's election are worth revisiting at the outset of this short volume is because they went on to inform media coverage of his presidency from start to finish. During the 2016 campaign, influential news organs that already tended to lean left politically became more openly ideological and oppositional in their White House reporting, not just on their editorial pages. In February 2017, The Washington Post added the slogan "Democracy dies in darkness" below its masthead to convey, according to the paper's spokesperson, who we are to the many millions of readers who have come to us for the first time over the last year. The New York Times went even further in discarding any pretense of objectivity in its coverage of Trump. An August 2016 front-page story by the paper's media reporter, Jim Rutenberg, said that it was necessary for his colleagues to move closer than you've ever been to being oppositional when writing about the Trump campaign. If you are a working journalist and you believe that Donald J. Trump is a demagogue playing to the nation's worst racist and nationalistic tendencies, wrote Rutenberg, you have to throw out the textbook American journalism has been using for the better part of the past half century. Moreover, this move to suspend professional standards was enthusiastically applauded by self-styled guardians of journalistic ethics. Writing in a 2016 edition of the Columbia Journalism Review, a leading industry publication, media studies professor David Mendich offered his imprimatur to political journalists who were abandoning the practice of steadfast detachment in favor of pushing explicitly against Trump's White House bid. Around the same time, a journalism professor at New York University wrote in the Washington Post that reporters must do things they have never done. Specifically, he instructed they must call Trump out with a forcefulness unseen before and explain to the public that Trump is a special case and the normal rules do not apply. The Washington Press Corps largely obliged the professor, but Trump won the election anyway, which not only annoyed but confused and even angered a media establishment that had spent the previous year telling the public that Hillary Clinton would win easily. The problem was not that the prognosticators called it the wrong way. The consensus view at the time, which I shared, was that Trump would be rejected by an electorate who saw him as unsuitable for the presidency. I predicted that Trump's inexperience and character flaws, his repugnant birtherism, and his disparaging remarks about women and immigrants would prove fatal to his campaign. I was wrong. Perhaps not surprisingly in hindsight, the sensibilities and priorities of political journalists based in places like Washington and New York turned out to be quite different from those of middle America. But upsets are not unheard of in politics, and Trump was an unconventional candidate who pulled a genuine upset. The problem was how the media responded to his victory. Having failed to anticipate the outcome, journalists proceeded to actively resist it and then spent 4 years willfully misinterpreting the reasons it happened. The narrative that gained the greatest currency among the elite media was that Trump's political rise was evidence of racial retrenchment. Trump opponents take his racism for granted, wrote Martin Gurry in a long, astute essay that recounted the former president's media coverage. He stands accused of appealing to the worst instincts of the American public, and those who wish to debate the point immediately fall under suspicion of being racist themselves. The dilemma, therefore, was not whether Trump was racist, that was a fact, or why he flaunted racist views, he was a dangerous demagogue, but rather how to report on his racism under the strictures of commercial journalism. Once objectivity was sacrificed, an immense field of subjective possibilities presented themselves. Reporters insisted that a surge of white bigotry had put Trump in the Oval Office, and that his victory over Clinton proved beyond any doubt that racism, sexism, and xenophobia in America were ascendant. This view prevailed even though numbers crunchers at the New York Times and elsewhere had pointed to empirical evidence that called it into serious question. For example, Trump won a smaller share of the white vote and a larger share of blacks, Hispanics, and Asians than Mitt Romney had won 4 years earlier. He also carried a majority of white women, even though he ran against one. And then there was the matter of which tranche of voters most likely put Trump over the top. It turns out that they were the very same people in battleground states like Michigan, Wisconsin, and Pennsylvania who had voted for Barack Obama in 2008 and 2012, it's clear that large numbers of white working-class voters shifted from the Democrats to Mr. Trump, reads a New York Times analysis from 2017. He flipped millions of white working-class Obama supporters to his side. The voter file data makes it impossible to avoid this conclusion. It's certainly possible that millions of white nationalists had spent the previous 8 years hiding out in the Democratic Party and throwing their support behind the first black president, but it's not very plausible. Nonetheless, this is the narrative that drove 4 years of Trump media coverage and is a major reason why the Trump economy, which benefited low-income minorities more than anyone, didn't receive nearly the amount of credit it deserved. What's more, this narrative that Donald Trump ushered in a new era of white supremacy in the United States became so entrenched that it persisted even after Trump significantly increased his level of minority support in his losing bid for a second presidential term. In 2020, Trump saw a dip in support among whites and an uptick in support among black, Asian, and Hispanic voters. The black increase is less impressive when put into context, but still notable. Between 1976 and 2004, Republican presidential candidates averaged around 11% of the black vote. John McCain won just 4% in 2008, and Mitt Romney 6% in 2012, but they ran against Barack Obama. In 2016, Trump, who didn't have that excuse, managed only 8% support among blacks, which was an improvement, but still below the pre-Obama norm. Trump's 4-point increase among blacks in 2020, which included a remarkable 6-point increase among black men, got the GOP back to its traditional share of the black vote in recent decades, even while the president was regularly portrayed as a racist in the press. Trump's performance.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.